Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Baka 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 podcast.
Baka!
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 It's amazing how every time you open your mouth, you prove you're an idiot.
Welcome to Baka Baka Baka. This is our anime podcast. It is our book club podcast where we watch an anime every 2 weeks and come together to talk about it right here on this podcast before turning it over to you and let you carry on the discussion. Give us your feedback on what you thought. We'll give you our Twitter and our email later. I'm first going to introduce our host. I am Troy. I'll be your guide this evening. With me is Jeremy. He is the knight to my nightshade.
Okay. Pretty good.
What you been up to, man?
It makes the poison, right? Together we just make poison.
Okay. That's right. We're nothing but darkness.
That's right. I've been doing pretty good. We had a pretty crazy day yesterday. The sewage backed up in the entire apartment complex. And jeez. We're on the bottom level. So that I have a very low bar for doing very good, apparently.
What anime is that?
I know, right? And then for animes, I finished watching Gurren Lagann. I wanted to watch the animes you guys mentioned on your top fives, and I thought, you know, I'm halfway through that, I should go finish it, and yeah, I got that done today.
Real quick, and be honest, was I full of BS, or was the ending as crazy as I said it would be?
The ending was as crazy as you said it would be, and I was thinking about how best to phrase it, and I think a succinct way is, it felt like every awesome anime I've ever wanted to see on fast forward combined. That's what it felt like.
Very so, nice.
It was good.
So also with us is the sun to my sunflower, Jason. What you been up to, man?
Path of Exile just came out with a new league, so I started there. But also we were discussing different animes that we would love to see. So I started watching Mushishi again. Just kind of a close anime to my heart. One of my first, like, wow animes I ever saw. So that's what I've been doing.
I have been trying to beat Persona 4, which is, you know, the anime of video games, right? Especially before Persona 5 comes out. I've also finally played Journey, and I don't know if you guys aren't PlayStation homeboys like I am, right? So.
You see Master Brace?
You don't. This is a game about wandering through the desert towards a mountain, and that's all there is. It's not much of a challenge. It has a multiplayer component, and I'm not going to spoil anything other than to say it was a huge experience. I've managed to not have it spoiled for me, and so it was everything everyone said it would be. So definitely check that out if you get the chance.
Is that a recent game?
It is not very recent now. PlayStation Network actually just released it for their games that they give out to every month. It's usually only a couple bucks when it's on sale, and I've always just been like, it's short. It took me like 2 hours to beat it. I beat it in one sit down.
Yeah, it's not the game I'm thinking of then.
Okay. Well, then we're going to go ahead and get on to our anime, which was My Hero Academia. This also could be referred to as Boku no Hero Academia in Japan. This was made by Studio Bones. They're also responsible for Full Metal Alchemist, Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood, and Soul Eater. If you watched our very first episode, which we refer to as Episode 0, then you will know that was my favorite anime, Full Metal Alchemist. And so have that studio. They're the powerhouse, right? They make great stuff. It was directed by Kenji Nagasaki, who's also directed Gundam Build Fighters, and I'm afraid I haven't seen that. So back to My Hero Academia. Before you guys watched this, what were you expecting?
Well, I thought that I was hoping it was going to be like Hunter x Hunter a little bit more gritty, a little bit darker. But I knew it was going to be about superheroes. I was curious to see what that sort of reflection would be, how they would take it. So, yeah.
How about you, Jason?
I actually had no expectations going into it, which was actually kind of nice, because when you guys described it to me, actually there was very little description. It was one of those, hey, this is the one we were going to watch, and it's about superheroes. So going into it knowing it was an anime is, you know, I know I'm not watching Marvel, right?
That's it.
so I was pleasantly surprised. So,
even though interesting note, the original manga writer was very heavily influenced by Western superheroes, and even especially one character design is supposed to be very much based on like Marvel and DC heroes.
It was Spider-Man, right? That's what I saw. I did a little bit of looking into it, and he just loved Spider-Man. Saw the movie and said, and "This is cool." Yeah.
So, Jason, why don't you give us your review of My Hero Academia in two sentences? Or three. I'll give you three. Yeah.
Okay.
You go to four, though, I am kicking you out.
Perfect. It was a fun anime that didn't dive as deep as I was hoping. It did some really interesting things with some tropes that we all know and love. On the other hand, there were some things that I wish they had changed up as far as tropes as well. And I was a little sad to see how the villains were not explored as much as I was hoping to in the first season, which I know is probably going to be more in the seasons to come. But for me, like, a really good story is a villain that I can hate or that I love to hate. So, but overall, I liked it.
Nice. How about you, Jeremy?
Well, I thought it was really action-packed. It had a lot of energy. I liked the quirks a lot, especially the way that the different characters had multiple facets to the quirks, and that was pretty cool. I didn't like how the quirks weren't always consistent. There were things that I felt should have been more clearly defined as being belonging to certain individuals, and not everybody has this, but that's kind of a standard thing with superheroes in general, which we'll get into later, I'm sure. I felt it started really strong. It carried itself really well through the first two-thirds. And then at the end, I know there's going to be a second season that's been approved, and I would like to see it still. But I was left feeling a little bit let down.
So this is my second time watching it. Before we even had the idea for this podcast, I'd already seen it and loved it without watching it with the eye of critical analysis, right? A very emotional high watching the episodes. And the second time through, not so much. The emotion was definitely still there, especially in a couple of places, but there are definitely some flaws in this anime. And so we just did a mini-sode a week ago where me and Jason argued about long-running shonen anime. And a lot of the flaws that I had talked about there, I see starting to show up here. And actually, when I first started watching, I didn't know it was that. And got a couple episodes in and was like, oh, I've fallen in love again. Well, and I'll only be hurt again. So definitely check out that episode for my thoughts on long-running anime and Jason's.
I was right, by the way.
You absolutely, yeah, sure.
I have to actually say I agree more with Troy in that one, but another time.
How don't dare you?
I know, right?
It, Jeremy, I'm just going to edit him.
Edit that out? Okay, awesome.
No one's ever going to hear you say that, sucker.
That's right.
Damn it.
All right, so we're going to go ahead and start going through the plot, you know, plot point by plot point. I do want to give a heavy spoiler warning at this point. If you have not seen the anime, turn us off, go watch it, unless you don't care. But we're going to be talking about everything that happens and really digging into characters and motivations, theories, you name it, it's coming. So this is your warning.
It's worth watching.
Okay, so let's go ahead and get started. This is a world of superheroes. 80% of the population in this world is born with a superpower, and our main character is in the 20% that wasn't. But he is the superhero fanboy of the world. He wants to be a hero more than anything. He studies every single hero, and that is Izuku Midoriya. Also, I'll be referring to him as Deku, which becomes his superhero name. It was also his nickname in grade school. Not much happens in the first episode other than setting up this character, setting up this world. You know, we see him going to his middle school. We learn that there's high schools for superheroes, that superheroes are running the world. We see in a flashback that he didn't get his power as a child where everyone else did, and how crushing it was to him, how he worshipped the hero All Might, watched his YouTube video every single night in a great scene. We also meet his school bully, Katsuki Bakugo. Katsuki Bakugo has the ability to shoot explosions from his hands and very highly dislikes Deku and is the one who calls him Deku, meaning he's a worthless bug. Assaults him in class for him even wanting to be a hero. And then this episode ends with poor Deku going home, bullied, downtrodden, refusing to give up hope, and then attacked by a supervillain made of slime. The supervillain made of slime tries to take over his body and kill him, and he is saved by his own hero, All Might. All Might captures the slime monster and jumps away. Unfortunately, Deku grabs onto him and gets carried away with it. Your guys, let's, before we get into the episode, what are your guys' thoughts on our main characters here?
I really, again, talking about the tropes, a lot of tropes here, but they were done in a very fun way. And also, I loved the 80-20 split where the 20% was normal.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That was really neat. The one problem I had, and I think this is a long-running problem that we'll talk about a little bit later, is the relationship between Katsuki and Izuku is not fleshed out, and it's frustrating for me because you have this bully where they used to be friends, and you don't understand why Katsuki hates him so much, especially as they get older. But we'll talk about that later. But I felt this was a perfect opportunity to establish that feeling and that emotion, and I felt it fell flat.
Yeah, when I first watched it, I thought, you know, I'm sure we're going to get this backstory eventually of why they hate him. And then I watched the second time, and they kind of do give us the backstory, and it's not that good.
And
the two characters are super important to each other in each other's development and their reflections of each other. And that, you're right, that backstory needed to be a little bit better.
Well, I actually think that after I was watching the later parts, which I don't know if you wanted to go into a little bit here or wait until we get to those.
As long as it's really focused on the character, we should be fine.
Yeah. Okay. I thought that it gave enough to give us a sense that Kachan has a personality that basically says, I have been rolling critical successes all my life. I was a leader before I had my powers. I had the coolest powers, so now I remain the leader. Nobody ever questions me. And therefore, when Deku winds up trying to help him at any point, that looks like he's trying to usurp his position or suddenly force a bad role on him, so to speak. And I think that Kachan is a spoiled brat, basically, and that would kind of define his perceptions.
He very much is. And Kachan is Bakugo's nickname from Deku. That's what he calls him. And I agree. I don't want to compare the show too much to Naruto, but I feel like they have a lot of similar comparisons. And if you take, like, Sasuke from Naruto, his backstory was, my entire family was murdered by my brother, and this guy is, I'm just kind of a jerk and I have a superiority complex because everyone was thinking I was so cool.
See, he reminded me of Vegeta. Especially by around episode 6. It was like, this is Vegeta. I mean, this guy's, yeah, he's so spoiled. He's, I should be praised. I should be number one. I should be on top of everything in every chart and, you know, getting number one later in the trials. And it seems like that's what he's pissed about, is that anybody could doubt him. And it's pathetic, but that's kind of why he's pathetic.
It's also unrealistic. Even for someone with that kind of pride, I don't want to argue too much about it, but like, I felt the reasoning was super shallow and not explained. Because obviously with any story that has a basis in some sort of reality where you're trying to relate to the character, everything about the reason Katsuki is so angry is unrelatable, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm. I'll disagree, but that's, yeah, we'll agree to disagree.
These two are going to come up again, for sure.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Another thing I want to point out with this episode is, and this is for all episodes, the theme song in this show is fantastic. I added it to my playlist. I love it. I listen to it in English. I've listened to it in Japanese. Love it either way. The background, this is one of the few animes I've noticed the background music, and there's a couple times where it is on point.
Absolutely.
Especially at the very end of this episode where Deku is asking All Might, can I be a hero? And the music swells up, and that's on point. All right, let's go on to episode 2, guys, where we meet All Might. And right after asking this question that I just referred to, All Might turns into his actual form. So normally he is this huge, muscular, Western American superhero-looking guy, eyes squinty and closed, huge smile. He's always smiling, and he transforms into this gangly, scrawny, sickly old man. Maybe not even old, but yeah. Aged, right?
Emaciated. Yeah.
So he, you know, reveals he was injured in a fight long ago, and he can only hold his superhero form for 3 hours a day now. And he rejects Deku's question. No, you can't be a hero. You don't have the power. Go join the cops. No. You could help, maybe. Not my problem, kid. But we find out that he dropped the slime monster, and that slime monster attacks Bakugo and tries to get into his body, especially since it has a great power, just like he did Deku's in the last episode. All Might, in his withered form, comes across this, can't help. All the other heroes can't help because of the fire and the slime. Their powers can't neutralize it. Deku walks by and makes eye contact with Bakugo and rushes in to save him past everybody else, even though he's completely helpless. It's pretty ineffective, but in this moment, All Might is inspired, turns back into a superhero form, destroys the slime monster, and saves both boys. This, for me, was the emotional hook of the show. Episode 1 hadn't really grabbed me yet. When I saw this in episode 2, I knew I was watching this whole show.
See, that's really interesting to me, because when I was watching episode 1 is when I actually got the emotional hook. Now that you mentioned emotional hooks, because seeing the little kid and how excited he was to watch his idol on the computer screen on his YouTube channel, and then seeing how absolutely distraught he was, or was that in this episode?
They refer back to it in this episode. Before he runs out, they really emotionally build up this moment. Right.
You know,
his mom told him he can't be a hero. His hero told him he can't be a hero. And we see that scene again. But you're right. That was a very emotional scene.
Oof.
But that wasn't my hook yet.
This was yours.
Yeah, this one was mine.
That makes sense. This was a really, really good emotional hook, too. Yep.
For me, the hook in this episode, it was for me. But when All Might turns into this gangly form, really threw me for a loop, because I didn't see it coming, and to have this this personification of Western style heroes turn into this just helpless, injured stick of a man, it was just great, because I love seeing those American stereotypes from the point of view of other cultures.
Yeah, very much so.
And so that was for me. It was just like, yes.
Tanya loved that as well. She was sitting on the couch and she goes, "Wait, what? What?" And then a moment later she goes, "Oh, Captain America. He's Captain America from before he got his injection, right?"
Reverse Captain America,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, he's reverse Captain America. That was awesome.
All Might for me is a little bit of a love hate. I love his personalities. He has two personalities. You know, there's the superhero always smiling, "You can do it, thumbs up." And then there's, "Hey kid, you know, the world sucks and that's just the way it is. I'm emancipated and people get hurt every day." Yeah. I love the personalities. I don't actually enjoy either character design. They both feel out of place in the anime compared to every other character design.
Oh, that's really interesting, because when he drew up All Might, they told him, no, we don't want to use this character. Nobody's going to be able to identify with it. He looks like an old man. His art style is totally different. He said, I'm going to go with it anyway. So you caught that. You feel the same way.
I love the idea he went for. I love the idea of the Captain America reverting back to, you know, the sickly self. He's so square in his sickly form, right? Where everyone else is very rounded. And the superhero form, because it is way more Western inspired than the other character designs, it also stands out really extreme. It's not, I don't dislike it to a point where it ruins it for me at all.
But
like I said, I love personality. I wish his character design had come a little closer to the others. So we also, at the end of this episode, get the line, this is the story of how I became the world's greatest hero, which is a pretty cool moment. That came from Deku, because at the end of the episode, after All Might saves him, All Might finds him walking home and tells him, I'm going to make you a hero. You can be a hero. And Deku has his sixth cry in the past two episodes.
Yes.
I have a small theory. Deku does have a quirk, and it's to generate super amounts of water.
You're exactly right. This was a moment where, if you see what he does in this crying session in particular, he grabs his heart. And I thought this actually made a lot of sense. They did a really good job portraying just how intense his emotion would be at this point, because he's lived however long up until this point. I think he's 14, right? So he's lived for 14 years obsessing over heroes, writing his analysis book and everything, basically having obsessive compulsive disorder more or less over the one thing that he can never have. Mm. So that kind of a traumatic outburst of relief, that was really cool that they drew him like grabbing his heart and falling down, and I like that. That was good. But yes, excessive crying, and it doesn't stop here.
So let's go on. So the next we start with our big training montage. Deku cannot have All Might's power immediately. The power is called One for All, and it can be passed, which has never been heard of before. Deku points that out to everyone. The training montage is he has to clear garbage from a beach while also keeping a diet and doing good in school because he wants to get into the prestigious superhero school. We get a huge training montage here. And then the day of the exam, All Might comes to the beach and it's completely clear, and we see Deku in all his ripped form while crying.
and yelling. Oh, man, was that a yell.
Not out of his nose. It was actually a really cool moment. But then he goes to the school for the big test, and they find out they're going to be battling robots in a mock battle simulation. Different robots, depending on difficulty, give different amount of points, and also to avoid the dangerous zero-point robot, right?
Mm-hmm.
So the test begins, and Deku has no idea how his power works, because that morning, he ingested a hair from All Might, because he has to ingest his DNA, and thank you for keeping it to just his hair.
When I heard that was how he was transferring his ability, his quirk, I thought immediately in my head was like villains taking a bite out of his hair, right? Or whatever DNA, a nail or something, collecting them, right? And I just pictured this army of villain All Mights. And of course they did kind of touch on this a little bit later, and it seems like they might have eliminated it. One of the issues, like you certainly couldn't have more than one. But this immediately flared up in my head, like this is not good. But I think they solved it fairly well.
It does seem to be by will, right? Like he has to choose it. That was the impression I got. So Deku does his test, and he mostly is failing. He cannot find a robot to destroy. We see the other heroes running around destroying robots fast, and we see a guy with super speed. He's got a ton of points. We see a girl who can make things float. She's got a ton of points. We see belly button laser. Belly button laser, guys. But Deku can't, he doesn't know how his power works, and he can't find any robots to destroy. Just when he's about to give up, give up's the wrong word, right? Just as he's about to despair, the giant zero-point robot rears its head, it's as tall as a building, and the girl who can make things float gets trapped under rubble, All the other heroes do what they were told. They run away. There's not worth bothering with. Plus, it's huge. Deku does what Deku does best, and he lunges in without thinking. His power activates. He jumps as high as a skyscraper, and he punches this thing straight in the face and knocks it, destroys it in one hit. Then he falls hurtling towards his death with his legs broken and his arm broken. And we find out that when he uses his power, his body still can't handle it, and it shatters it. Right before he hits the ground, he is saved by the girl who can make things float, and everything comes out okay. He returns home, assuming he failed the test because he got 0 points, but we do find out that there's a second parameter to the test that no one's told about, and that's your ability to rescue people. Since his self-sacrifice was so great, he got 60 self-sacrifice points, and he got into the school. The second emotional hook for me, right? The jump, the punch, the quote from All Might as he does it, just clench your butt cheeks and yell, smash!
Yes! That was awesome. That was hysterical.
I think at this point for me, because it's said a couple times, again, it's that play on American-style heroes, and just to, like, clench that, like, all the smashes have, like, Detroit smash.
Yeah, they're all states and cities of America.
Yes, their attacks are based on states. Texas smash, yes. Delaware smash.
Yeah. And southern states, too, which is really great. So, anyways, I had to throw that in there.
Yep, that was really funny. I got a kick out of when Infinity Girl was barfing a rainbow. That was hysterical. It caught me completely off guard. I'm like, wait, is that like part of her quirk? Oh, no, that's just being cute. Okay, I get it.
I'm going to point this out a couple times. There are some really humorous moments in this that catch you off guard and make you laugh out loud.
Yes. Kissy face old lady.
The comedy in this anime worked very well for me.
Yes, me too as well.
Well, like in this episode, or in one of these two episodes, they mention the top three heroes, right? And there's All Might, and there's Fire Guy, and then there's Best Genius, and he's just clothed from head to toe in blue jeans.
Yeah. I still want to know what the heck that guy's powers are.
How are you the best?
Yeah, exactly.
This is the first anime I've ever seen about where there's a training montage, you know, get powerful, Goku, go train in the hyperbolic time chamber, where they talk about rest days. Did you guys catch that?
Yes.
Deku mentions, you know, I got to factor in the rest days, and All Might talks about that as well. You never hear that in anime. Mm-hmm. You know, there's One Punch Man, do 100 push-ups every day.
Yes.
If your bones break. And this is the first anime that's like, no, there's a way to do it.
Yeah.
In fact, when Deku doesn't take into consideration the rest days and he starts falling behind, All Might chastises him for it.
I have to say that in this particular episode, episode 4, I got the impression that they took a little bit too long to reveal that he got into the school. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but when he was in there and he leaped up and he punched the fortress, right, the zero-point robot, I was thinking, oh my god, they didn't take into account rescue points. He's got no other points. They've got to give him points to get in. There's got to be rescue points. And so the whole time I'm waiting, it felt like it dragged on a really long time, and there was this emphasis on his angst and on his and so that felt like it took too long. But then I was talking to Tanya about it because she felt the same way, so I decided to argue against that. And the only thing that conclusion I came to was that it gave us such a good connection with his character, that this was his sense of, I know that I don't deserve this opportunity. I know that I should be failing. This is too good to be true. And so in this situation, it wouldn't even come to his mind that he, you know, would have gotten in because of rescue points, or that there could be some secret way or something. So that was interesting.
For me, it was a bit predictable. Mm. 'Cause I mean, you know, this is the main character. This is entry into the school that it's called My Hero Academia. So, I mean, obviously this kid's going
He's
to this
get in.
So I agree a little bit that it was drug on a bit because, yeah, he's obviously getting in. It's just, how is he going to do it? But I also agree with you. this is one of the huge strong points for this particular anime is their character building is phenomenal. Mm-hmm. You really find yourself caring about each and every character. Well, most of them.
Even the character you get very brief moments with.
Yeah.
They're still great. They're still, you're absolutely right. You nailed it on the head.
Yep.
Because they don't even need a lot of time to make you start caring about a character.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Speaking of characters, we meet a bunch in the next episode. So we've already met the girl who can control gravity. Her name is Ochako. And what was her superpower name later?
Infinity Girl, I think.
Yes.
Okay. Infinity Girl.
That's what I call her.
She is the first girl to ever talk to Deku. So he's, of course, hopelessly in love with her.
Of course.
And she can reverse gravity by touching things. But if she holds it too long, she gets sick to her stomach and throws up.
Rainbows.
We also meet Tenya Ida, or Ida for short, who has engines in his legs so he can run at super speeds.
I don't like his power.
Kind of weird how it works, but there's a couple powers that are like, why do you have machines in your legs? How did that evolve from your biology?
Yep.
Like sticky tape from the elbows.
Yes.
That would actually frustrated me a little bit.
The reason I don't like Ida's powers are because when there's a later episode where he gets anti-gravved and you get to see the effect and where the propulsion's coming from, it is definitely only coming from his calves, because when he uses it, it sets him spinning in a circle. So
sexy, sexy calves.
Yes, his sexy, sexy calves. But that just, oh God, it just doesn't work for running. I mean, if they'd had him come out of shoulder blades and some other areas too, I'd be like, okay, you got it. That's fine. The calves, sorry, go ahead.
So these characters meet, they all attend their first day of school. Deku is in the same class as Ka-chan, you know, Bakugo, his former bully. This does not sit well with Bakugo, who we've seen in a flashback actually threaten Deku for trying to get in the school, and Deku stands up to him for the first time. Why not? I've seen his bod, man. You can take him.
Now.
And then we meet their teacher, who is Shoto Izaiwa, also known as Rosevere. I probably said that name wrong, and I apologize for that. He is a sleepy, tired, grumpy mess of a man, but his power is that he can look at someone and nullify their power.
So, before you go on, I would like you to describe how he is first introduced, because it's one of my favorite scenes throughout this whole thing.
So the class comes together and is introducing themselves and trying to figure out what's going on. And there's a man laying under a desk in a sleeping bag, and it's one of those sleeping bags that come over your head, and you just see his face, and he's like, would you all be quiet so I can start teaching the class?
Yep.
And everyone loses their minds.
Yep. He's awesome.
So he, to make this short, he takes everyone out for testing of their powers. He wants to know what everyone's limits are, and he definitely does not like Deku. Because he also does not like All Might, and he finds Deku's power useless, because if you destroy your body every time you use your power, you're now a liability to everyone else. He wants Deku gone, so he tells everyone, hey, we're doing these tests, use your powers to excel in them. Things like throwing a ball, running the 100-meter dash. Whoever gets last place in all these tests is out.
Expelled.
Expelled from the school. When Deku finally decides to use his power, which is to throw the ball, his power is canceled, and the teacher tells him, no, if you break your arm, again, using your power, I'll expel you right here. You have to be able to complete the other test. Even if you suck at him, you have to be able to go on. Deku focuses and is able to channel all the power into just his fingertip, shattering his finger, but throwing the ball farther than even Ka-chan was able to, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Was it farther? I don't know for sure. I know it was
just a little bit further.
Was it? Okay.
Ochako, she did the best, right, with the infinity.
Oh, yeah.
We also get to see everyone's powers on display and how creative they can be, like Belly Laser using it to propel himself in the race. Same thoughts as I had. Again, this teacher is a great character who's awesome right away. Very different from everyone else. great power. He has that scarf that he can grab people with. Your guys' thoughts on this episode?
I loved it. I thought this episode was great. I really believed the teacher at first because I was looking for an anime where, you know, there would be some really hard consequences for things. And so I thought, wow, this is great. You know, they're going to get rid of somebody right away. And then when he flipped it around and he said, you know, hi, I was bluffing. I was just joking. But you know he wasn't. You know, he was being honest.
Because he confronts, All Might confronts him and is like, you weren't kidding. You
wanted
to kick someone out.
Yeah, and I thought that meant, in my book, they actually kept that hard grittiness because you know, as the observer, that he was going to do this, and they still get the get-out-of-jail-free card because they managed to keep Deku and not kick him out, even though he got last place. And so that meant that this guy was a nice enough person to see his potential, even though he couldn't act on it right now. That was really cool. I like his character a lot.
I liked the episode. It was pretty good. I love Eraserhead. He's his character needs some more fleshing out, as in far as explanation. Because yes, he can nullify someone's ability just by looking at them, but that's not explained. Like, is it anyone he looks at? Is it an ability he can flip on and off as he looks at somebody? And then how can he control his scarves the way he does? So, like,
yes,
those the aren't scarves. They
don't explain. I do think they explain that he
they, turns yeah, they do.
And off. And it actually hurts his eyes to use. That's why he got the red eyes and has to put in eye drops.
Right.
But they do, near the end.
Yeah.
Someone finds out the secret to his trick, right?
Right.
And kind of explains it to us.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say that I remember that they said he can only look at one person at a time, right, which would mean that he's not actually shutting them down, but he's just holding the power at bay until he looks away.
Which is why he wears goggles, so you can't. So in a fight, you can't tell who he turns off.
Yeah. Right.
I thought it was an interesting way that the writers helped Deku throw the ball with just like focusing his power into one spot. And I think also it was brilliant of the writers to like give this boy one of the most powerful abilities throughout this entire anime, but have him limited in a way that he has to literally shatter his body and create immense amounts of pain just to use it, therefore limiting him and forcing him to use his mind, even though his heart is one of the most courageous throughout the anime.
I'm actually glad you said that, because my biggest worry about the future of this anime is how do you keep that up? Because eventually he's going to learn how to control his power. You can't ride on just this one thing, right? This one crutch of he breaks himself every time he uses it. How do you keep his power that interesting? When that's taken away, is he still as interesting as a character?
And I think what I like about his power, and we'll see in further episodes, that he's able to utilize it in more than just brute strength to hurt somebody. He's able to use it as a utility. So that was pretty neat. But the camaraderie, but then also showing Eraserhead, like his thing was not, are you worthless or not, but what is your potential? And there's obviously some tension between him and All Might, which I can't wait to see that explored. So.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I also thought there were a couple other interesting things here. Like the way Kachan responded when Deku threw that ball, Kachan was on him like crazy. Right? And I thought, wow, that is intense. This guy, he got nothing but villain points and he got first place, if I remember correctly. Right? They're really foreshadowing.
Right. Right. He even when the big robot showed up, he didn't stop destroying little robots. He was,
He's taking them out.
He's a combat specialist.
Yeah. And so I thought, man, this guy, he is a villain waiting to happen. This is amazing. And the other thing was All Might's poetry. I love his poetry. The flame is still small, but it will be exposed to wind and rain. And Groba, what? Wind and rain? And then he says, yeah, that's deep. As he's running, it's like commenting on his own poetry. Thought that was great. Great sense of humor.
We're going to keep going, because the next two episodes were quite a big story moment. After the test, the next day, All Might takes the class for a training exercise, and they all get their costumes. And we find out Deku's costume was personally designed by his mother from a notebook that he had drawn it in, that it was heavily inspired by All Might, and his mom builds this form as a way of apologizing for not believing in that he could be a hero as a kid. Now, she doesn't know what's happened to her son or where his power came from, but that's a very big moment that they've been building up, that his mom didn't, you know, when he was a kid, his mom told him, no, I'm sorry, you can't be a hero, and held him while he cried when that was the only thing he needed to not hear, right? And this is where she admits, she realizes her mistake at this moment and builds him his own homemade costume, where everyone else gets a school-supplied one that's cool and flashy, and he's got, like, a green jumpsuit with gloves and boots.
Goofy rabbit suit.
And the goofy rabbit ears that embarrass All Might, because his hair has goofy rabbit ears.
And the huge teeth on the front.
Yes. It's so terrible.
I can't stand that mask. I'm like, please take it off.
Yeah.
Why is that there?
Yeah.
Well, we find out, so the training exercise is that they would pair it up, and then one team will play heroes and one team will play villains, and the villains have to guard a nuclear bomb. I'm using air quotes on the video for you audio listeners. Nuclear bomb. It's just a fake one. And the villains have to protect their base with the bomb in it, and the heroes have to either capture the villains or breach the bomb to win. Deku goes first, and he gets Infinity Girl as his partner. He also goes up against Ka-Chan and Ida, the speedster, as the villains. Ka-Chan, of course, who cares about this exercise? This is my... they've told me I can beat up Deku. And he rushes out to fight him, and the first of the storyline episode ends. Deku actually slams him to the ground. He's just like every hero, he's watched Ka-Chan his whole life and studied his every move, and he's able to anticipate his first attack, slams him into the ground. The fight goes on, and Deku runs away and hides, knowing he can draw Ka-Chan away while Infinity Girl sneaks up to the bomb. She starts fighting with Ida, but she can't get past his speed, and he removes every object from the room, so her power is now worthless. And he also has a great moment of trying to play the villain and monologue. Oh, I'm awesome. The villain. I'm going to monologue now.
Yep, that was great.
Bakugo goes all out on Ka-Chan to the point where he has to be told to limit himself because he's actually even destroying the building that's supposed to be the base he's protecting. He gets some good hits on him using, you know, his powers to speed himself up and be more agile. So Deku realizes he can't beat Ka-Chan in a fight without using his power. The two decide to go head-to-head. They rush at each other. Deku powers up. Ka-Chan pulls out his hands, ready to explode. Deku punches straight up instead, creating a giant hole throughout the entire building, giving Gravity Girl something she can use, and she's able to stun Ida with her by making the objects that have exploded in her room float, and is able then to jump and grab the bomb. Meanwhile, Deku takes Ka-Chan's blast full to the face. He gets an arm in front of himself, but he takes the attack full on. Technically, they win the exercise, but he's very seriously hurt. You know, his arm's wrecked again, his face is badly burnt, and that's how this episode ends. This is a awesome fight.
Mm. Yeah, I really enjoyed this fight because I never expected Deku to be able to take Ka-Chan toe-to-toe in actual physical combat. That was, when that happened at the end of episode 5 and beginning of 6, that was so cool. I thought, this is great. This is exactly how I wanted his book to be used. So he knows that Ka-Chan always leads with his right. That was awesome. And another thing was that Ka-Chan, he could have killed him. And they make that very clear. But he very specifically says, not if I don't aim at him. Not if I'm not shooting at him. When he unleashes that massive blast that blows a hole in the side of the building, he deliberately shoots right next to Deku instead of hitting him. So for me,
you watched the sub version, right?
I did.
So I watched the dubbed version. that was on Funimation. In English, he says, he'll be all right if he dodges. And he says it very loudly and clearly for Deku to hear.
That's very different.
Yeah, and All Might calls that out that, well, he did say that, right?
Yeah, that's very different. In subtitled, he specifically says, you know, not if I don't hit him, not if I don't punch at him, basically. And I thought that was really cool because it showed that Ka-chan, like he said at the beginning, you know, the fight won't be called to an end if I'm not going to put him into mortal danger. I'm not going to kill him. So even now, when Deku is insulting him by not even using his power and still holding his own against him, he doesn't lose his temper and just, you know, obliterate him. He still maintains control. I mean, this guy, he's got some layers. He's very interesting as a character.
Jason, what were your thoughts on this fight?
It was cool. I loved the cat and mouse game they played because, like Jeremy said, Ka-chan knew that he had an advantage over him with his ranged attack that actually nobody knew about until he was like, yeah, I got this costume specifically made so I can store my sweat inside these things and release it as like an explosion.
Yeah, because Ka-chan's explosions come from his sweat of his palms being nitroglycerin, right? So his gauntlets store the sweat off his palms, which is disgusting.
The dichotomy of this scene is interesting because Deku also knows that there's two issues that he's facing. One, if he uses his power full on to either protect himself or to win, he's out. So he's got a one shot chance. The other problem is he knows if he hits Ka-chan head on with his full power, he's going to kill him. Mm-hmm. So they both know that their powers can kill each other. They have this love hate relationship going on where Deku still admires him even though he wants to beat him. And he has this best friend care for him, even though it's not reciprocated.
So, yeah, that's something I wanted to call out. The nickname Ka-chan in Japan, Chan is something you add to a name. It's both childish, but it's also used for close friends, lovers, family members. This is a sign of affection between, you know, Midoriya and Kagero, and Kagero doesn't tell him not to say it. Kagero lets him call him Ka-chan. He's never like, wait, why would you call me Ka-chan? I'm mean to you. It's almost as if he's like, yeah, we are best friends, but I hate you. Right? And, you know, Deku, you know, he's going to take this nickname from Ka-chan and make it his superhero name, but it was a term of being put down. And yet, when he turned around and nicknamed Kagero, he called him Ka-chan, which is very important to this character, I think. Probably the biggest of their backstory, right? I mean, we complained about it earlier. This is that layer, I think, that gives it a little bit something special.
For me, this episode was one of the coolest scenes I've seen in a while for an anime. But also the storytelling and writing starts to fall apart a bit. And they even point it out at the end of the episode where I think it's Momo says that they basically cheat because the tactic they used to win the exercise, they most likely would not have used if it was a real life bomb.
Right. So in the next episode, they declare Ida the winner because he's the only one who actually did everything he was supposed to do. He followed the rules, he met his guidelines, he tried to work with his partner. So even though his team lost, Ida is declared the winner of that game.
The MVP, if you will. Yeah. But yeah, like I said, it was a really cool scene to see the entire building just get eviscerated by the All for One shot up north. But it was so reckless. If it wasn't an exercise, if the bomb wasn't papier-mâché, that wouldn't have flown in any other storytelling for a superhero
right
type.
This is also the episode where I feel like this. I felt like, oh, I'm watching a shonen anime. I'm watching Naruto. I'm watching the Bleach. This is the moment it really sets in and started to feel. It started to kind of fall into the tropes of the genre, right?
I was wondering, could you elaborate a little bit more on what you mean by the story falling apart? Because I don't know if I follow.
So they sacrifice interesting storytelling for needing to show a cool scene or to try to wedge in fun moments. So like I said, tearing the building apart, or Kachan just annihilating the side of the building with his gauntlet. Those were really cool scenes, but they weren't good. It wasn't good storytelling as far as a training exercise and trying to expand these characters into a way that flushes them out as like these school kids going through this training to become heroes.
Mm. See, I actually thought that the way they portrayed it was as these school kids who they knew that they were in a training simulation, and so there's always that thing in the back of your head that says, I know I'm not supposed to, but technically it's within the rules if I do A and B, and I think that's what Kachan was doing, at least in my mind. It was like the story was chronicling the behavior of these students and that they wouldn't necessarily do exactly what would happen if it was in a real live ammunition situation. So I don't know if I agree with that, because I think it chronicled their mistakes. And I think that gave us a connection to what these characters were like.
So I'm somewhere in the middle between you two guys. To Jason's point, Ochako and Ida literally sit in that room together doing nothing until Deku's big moment. But I do think, I think for Deku and Kaguro, there's still good storytelling going on because of their relationship, even if it's not fleshed out well enough. From now on, Deku is the name of the hero. I'm taking your nickname and I'm turning it on you. There's still some really good character moments in that. But we do have two characters that sit in a room, not fighting, waiting for something to happen. And Ida, there's no reason he couldn't have beat her, at least in my opinion. He could have at least tried. They literally just stood in a room waiting.
Yeah.
To your point way earlier, it's another one of those laugh out loud moments.
Ida's his criminal, his evil villain.
Yeah, yes. He's trying to play the part. That was
I did love it. And I love how conflicted he was about, I want to be a hero, but to be a hero, I must be a villain. We're going to go through the next three episodes, actually, because it all comes up to a big moment. But the rest of the next episode after this big fight is everyone else taking the test, and we're getting to see the other characters' powers. We're not really getting to meet them yet, but we're getting some flavor in, right? You know, one of the characters we meet is Takodori, and he wins his battle almost immediately by freezing the entire building. Now, this guy is, you know, he's half heat, half ice, and can obviously freeze things and unthaw things, and he wins his fight immediately. And probably the most important character, because Kaguro sees that and realizes, I'm not the best. There's competition for number one here. Even if Deku wasn't here, this isn't going to be easy. And he's already kind of sore after what just happened anyway. So his ego takes a big hit, right? Mm-hmm. Then we see, you know, like I said, the rest of the people take their test. We see some cool powers that we can call out when we come back. But Midoriya can only get healed so much, so he's still in Clench. He comes back to class, and he finds out he's actually kind of become the popular kid in class. Everyone saw his fight. Everyone thought that was really cool. No one understands quite what happened, but everyone's super friendly to him, which is a huge turnaround from middle school, right, where he was the outcast for everyone. And now suddenly he's part of the in-group. He finds out Kachan is leaving early for the day and runs outside to try to explain to him his situation, and he ends up telling him the truth about his power being inherited from All Might. And Kachan doesn't care or believe him. He says, that, you know, it doesn't matter. I don't care where you got this power. You've hid it from me, whatever. I'm still going to be the number one. You can't beat me. And he says, well, I am going to beat you. And then All Might shows up, tries to get some advice, and he's blown off by Ka-Chan as well. Then we go on to the next day. They have to pick class rep, and Deku wins. And we also see that the press is swarming the school because All Might has become a teacher here, and he's a huge celebrity hero. And we also learn about the defense system. So the press tries to get inside. Giant walls come up. No one that is not a staff member or student is allowed on campus at any time to protect the students. At the same time, we end up with a security breach on the same day where the press gets past the wall somehow. And the alarms go off, and the entire student body panics and cram all into one hallway. And Ida actually manages to come up with an idea, uses Infinity Girl's power to get above everyone and calm everyone down. This causes Midoriya to hand him the class representative position because he realizes, yeah, I'm not really the nervous wreck of a guy for this job. Ida gets it, and then the entire class is taken onto a field trip for rescue training at another facility that's still on the campus. This campus is huge. There's cities inside of it. There's worlds within worlds on this campus. When they get to this training, this rescue facility, which creates natural disasters, villains immediately teleport in, right? And only two of the three teachers are there because All Might, who was all supposed to be there, already used up his 3 hours doing hero work before school began, and he couldn't show up. So it ends up being Eraserhead who has to battle, and we meet our three main villains, plus, you know, there's a ton of villains, but there are three main ones. There's Tomaru Shigaraki, who I call the Handman, because he's just covered in hands in his costume.
That is such an awesome character design.
Then we have Portal Guy, who I didn't actually get his real name, and I apologize for that. He's just a big purple mist that also turns out to be a bartender. Who can create portals. His body is a portal, and he can create portals around himself. And he's the one who brings all the villains in.
Kurogiri. Yeah. Kurogiri. Yeah.
Thank you. And from now on, we will be referring to him as Portal Guy. there's no way I'm getting through that name. And there's also Nomu, who I originally was calling Bird Brain, because he is a giant... He's the face of a bird, but he's a giant monster of a man, and his brain is sticking out of his head.
Yep, really exposed.
Yep.
And these are the three main of the focus. Everyone else is basically red shirts that they brought, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Eraserhead decides to attack the villains, while a new hero that we meet, number 13, who is someone who can create black holes from an astronaut suit, right? Was the boy in the dub? Was he a girl in the sub?
She sure sounded like a girl.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hard to tell with the
different voice actors?
In the dub, he referred to it as a black hole. I'm sure it's not a real black hole, because he sucks things up and turns it into dust, right? In the dub, he did refer to it as a black hole, but that's probably just to create the imagery of the sucking, right?
So you're right. It is a man. The sub, it's a woman's voice.
Yeah.
The ability is called black hole, but it's not an actual black hole in his finger. It's just, but if he does suck something into it, it does get destroyed into dust.
Yeah. See, the reason I was wondering is because if it was a black hole, it totally would not have worked the way it did in the later episodes. That really, really confused me, but I kept referring back to it being something that turned whatever he sucked into his suit into dust, and I thought, well, I guess it could work, but that's later.
So Eraserhead starts this fight, and even though he's holding his own, Portal Guy manages to get past him to all the students. Bakugo, and I don't know the name of the character who can create his arms into iron, right? I call him Iron Arms, right? I didn't get his name. And he's one of the top most powerful students as well. They both attack this portal guy, And so the portal guy decides to send a large group of the students into random places around this rescue facility into the different natural disasters. And Deku gets sent into the lake, where he's immediately attacked by water villains and is saved by the greatest character this anime has ever created.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Sue, or Suya, but call me Sue, who is a young lady with frog-like powers. A super long tongue, she can swim really good, she can jump, and she can stick to walls. She had some other powers that were kind of gross, but they're not going to be helpful in this situation.
And I thought they were saved by Minoru.
Minoru? Who's that? Who's that?
The sticky head guy.
Oh, God. Later. I don't know why he's in that class. Maybe he comes into his own later, but oh, my God.
So she also saves Purple Ballhead.
Yes.
Or exactly. Grape, whatever you want to call him.
Futurama boy.
And they get onto a boat in the middle of this lake and are surrounded by villains. They find out that besides Sue's powers, Purple Ball Boy, he can pull these balls off of his head, and they are super sticky, but to everyone except for him, he bounces off of them, right? Yeah. And they regrow right back after he pulls them off, but if he goes too fast, he'll bleed from his head. And Deku realizes they can use their powers in combination to get out of the situation. He jumps out off from the boat, uses his finger smash, the Delaware smash, right?
Yep.
Which is just his finger, creates a giant hole in the water, thus all the water rushes in, pulling all the villains in. Meanwhile, Sue jumps out, grabs him, carrying Grape, and Grape throws all his sticky balls. In the greatest line ever, "You can eat my sticky balls!"
Yes.
Into the water. So all the balls and all the villains come into one area, stick together into one giant ball, and these three manage to defeat their villains. We also see the other students in small groups fighting back against the villains, right? So I will stop there before we get into the rest of... We'll finish off the anime in our next session. Up to this point, so we have the rest of the testing, we have the start of the field trip and the class presidency, and also the start of this villain attack. What were your guys' thoughts?
Go ahead, Jeremy, because I've got some stuff I want to go over.
Okay.
One of the feelings to work out.
Yeah. This is one of those moments where I look at the characters' quirks and I go, I don't really understand how this works. So you've got the earbud girl who can stick her earbud thing into either her leg. But in the test, she actually sticks it into the wall, which means that this earbud thing can penetrate into concrete, and it has the force to do this, and it can also take information from the building so she can hear with it. But later, she uses it to plug into her leg in a special port and output her heartbeat, so it also acts as a microphone. Right. So I was like, how did she get it to go in the concrete? How strong is this thing? Is this something that can be used later to, like, stab through a villain? Like, what is going on with this? I'm not getting a really clear image of just what her power is. I know that it's sound. I know it's microphone and speakers, but that confused me, seeing it just stick into the concrete.
That seems a little trivial for, like, yeah, I'm down with the fact her earlobes she can control manually and grow.
That's okay. Anything, that's okay.
The shape-shifting.
Yeah. That just blew my mind. I was like, this doesn't make sense. Momo, I loved it. There was a scene in episode 8 where she has a literal shelf of books on her butt. That was hysterical to me. Absolutely hysterical. And Purple Grape Guy always reminds me of the little monster from Futurama that can poop out dark matter. That's what he reminds me of. He looks just like him. He looks so much like him.
To you guys' earlier point, how did he get into this school? How did he destroy robots?
Yeah. But maybe he stuck them together or something. But that wouldn't be enough. I don't know.
How did he get past Eraserhead's could be expelled?
Oh my god, yeah.
We see him in one scene in the testing where they have to do the line jump back and forth, and he puts a group of balls on each side and then just starts bouncing rapidly between them. So he did put on at least one test.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
But I don't. A couple of these heroes don't have very offensive abilities, and I see them and I'm like, how did you get past opening day?
Yeah, like the Invisible Girl or the Tail Guy. I mean, they just, I don't know.
They mentioned some get in by reference, but I don't think there was any of these heroes.
Yeah. But the other thing with this was I thought that over this span of episodes, this little arc right here, is where we see Deku and Kachan trade places. And I thought this was really cool because they start out with Kachan obviously being the most popular, the most powerful. He's got a social group. And Deku's the outcast. And now we get Deku being popular, getting a social group. And then Kachan is actually teased on the bus, and Deku has like this panic attack, like, oh my god, Kachan's being teased.
I wrote it down, personality is a flaming crap filled with garbage.
God, I loved it. That was so awesome. That was so great. Yeah. And I thought another funny thing was when they had they were showing inside of the big training tower for rescue operations. They showed, you know, we have the fire area and the ice area and the miscellaneous, and it just showed like this mountain. But that's great. That's great. So there's more, but I'm sure it'll come up as you talk. Go ahead.
I had really mixed feelings about this particular story arc, and it's one of the things I was alluding to with the storytelling falling apart back in the training. But I gotta get this off my chest. Iron Hand Man, I find him to be one of the most worthless superheroes in this group, okay? I'd take Sticky Ball Guy over him. Anyways. And yeah, Invisible Girl, it's like, okay, what else can you do? Anyway, okay, pass that.
But she's naked. Whoa!
Yeah, Momo gets her clothes blown off. But anyways, what was frustrating to me is it felt like you went through, what are we? We're on episode like 10, 8 or 10 here? And
this is 8, 9, 10.
8, 9, 10. We've got this really cool idea for a school of superheroes in this population of quirk-filled populace. And all of a sudden, we're getting near the end of this first season, and all of a sudden the writers go, oh, well, we have superheroes. I guess we need to throw in supervillains. And so then all of a sudden these villains come out of nowhere. We don't know who they are. They're not explained well. Their powers are not flushed out. There's no reason for them to, like, they're literally no reason for them to hate these people or why they're so angry or why they feel they need to kill All Might. The reason they give is, oh, he's the symbol of peace. We need to take him out. It was so generic when they had such cool storytelling with this vast array of quirks that we've just been discussing and this cool idea of this populace that is all quirks. And now you've got these guys, they needed villains, so here's some villains. And that was frustrating.
I agree. The villains are just there. And this is where they finally start introducing some of the side characters, right?
And they're so cool. Like, their powers, like, when you find them out, and, like, their voice actors, their mannerisms, and who they are as individuals are so cool. I love the villains. But they're a side thought, and they shouldn't be.
I think that this is a situation where, if you go back to episode, I think it's 3, there's a quote from Napoleon Bonaparte that's used, and it is, a true hero is someone who overcomes life's misfortunes. And I think that that is, like, the sole message of this series as a whole, which is typical of shonen. Not a bad thing, but it does show the progression of more and more difficult obstacles. And so with the focus so tightly bound to Deku and All Might, I think it was a progressive series of, well, what is it that's going to be an obstacle for Deku right now? And that's going to be getting a power. Then it's going to be getting into school. And so I think the villains kind of just show up. Yeah, they show up a lot all at once, and therefore they can't have a lot of detail. But I think that it's something that's presented, since we know we're getting this from Deku's perspective, since he's narrating at the beginning and the end. I also wonder how much of it is having that perception, maybe I'm just reading into it, but having that perception be, there's a lot going on, and I only know what I've been told and what I could observe in the moments. And so, therefore, the characters are presented maybe not as well fleshed out as they should be if you didn't get a lot of interactions with them.
I also, I'm a little worried they use some really great powers with some of these villains. Like, in the water part, there's a villain who can literally create, like, limbs out of water, right? He makes a giant hand and cuts the boat in half, and he's gone in 5 seconds. Like, that would have been a great character. That's a really powerful power. And he's gone. Yeah. And, yeah. You know, I wonder if they had the... And there was some cool in the Eraserhead fight, too, where people had some really cool powers, and they just... Okay, well, that's gone forever now.
One of the other things that I thought was really interesting was that this is a situation where we get a little bit of what I would call slice of life in this, because that period of time when they're in the cafeteria, they're just hanging out at school, they're going through their classes, they're talking about the press, and then all of a sudden it breaks out into a panic. Why was no one using their quirks? Like, nobody was crawling out of the windows using their abilities or flying or hovering above anybody or no one. They all turned into sardines in a can stomping each other to try to get to the door. This is one of the many things that I'm going to allude to later when I talk about what I think is a theory about what's going on, whether the artist and author of this designed it to be this way or whether I'm just reading into it. But I think all the pieces are in place. So I'll get into what it is later, but I thought that was really weird.
Let's start this final battle. So we start with Deku and his group, and they decide they want to go help Eraserhead. And when they get there, Eraserhead gets taken down because the guy covered in hands has figured out Eraserhead's weakness, and that is he does have to hold the eyesight, and he can only do it for so long, and his hair goes up every time he does it, and his hair comes down every time he turns it off. So the hand guy is able to get a touch him, and this hand guy's ability is to disintegrate anything he touches. He wipes out Eraserhead's elbow. However, the portal guy he's not having as much luck. He manages to take out 13. He uses the black hole power on him, and then he just uses a portal to turn it against 13. 13 ends up hurting himself. But Ida, with the help of the students who are still with him, manages to sprint past him, get to the door, and run away. And he was told to do this to go get the other teachers, to go get the pros, right? We need help. We can't handle this, just us. So Ida gets away. Portal guy goes back to Handman and says, jig's up. All Might's not showing. They're going to get help. And so Hank is like, fine, let's just kill some kids. And he goes for Sue and really cements his villainy. We see everyone trying to save Sue. Eraserhead tries it first and gets his face smashed for it. So Deku jumps in with his smash and manages to use his power for the first time ever without any backlash. But he hits Nomu, this giant bird brain monster. Whose power is absorption. One of his powers is absorption. And he hits him and has no effect.
Specifically, shock absorption. Go ahead.
Right. Thank you. Mm-hmm. So Nomu absorbs his blow, and then the villains come in for the final kill, and the episode ends. All Might arrives, and everyone just freezes. You know? So All Might comes in. He saves everyone in seconds. Grabs Eraserhead, grabs Midoriya, Sue, Grape, gets them all away, tells them, you guys go join the other students by the entrance, I'll handle these bad guys. He starts fighting and is a little overmatched because the portal guy manages to get him trapped when he tries to do a body slam. And all the portal guy has to do is crush him. Deku realizes that All Might already used his 3 hours today, doesn't have any time left on his power. He decides to go back, but before he can get there, three other kid heroes arrive. Bakugo shows up, the Iron Hands guy, and Toshiro. Oh man, I messed up his name. Ice Kid, Toshiro, right? Tokidori. Yep. His name's Tokidori. Tokidori shows up. Tokidori actually does the most. He freezes Nomu. And with that, All Might is able to shatter one of his arms and get away. is when we find out that Nomu also has regeneration. He's able to heal from this. Bakugo manages to pin the portal guy down because he realizes where his body is hiding in his purple mist. Because of this, the villains attack these kids, and All Might has to take a blow from Nomu, and he tells the kids, okay, no, you stay back. I got this. All Might begins his attack on Nomu. The portal guy's like, yeah, it's fine. I'll jump in. The blows become so powerful that he can't even get close. The force is pushing him back, right? And we get some great lines from All Might in this fight where he's talking about what it takes to be a real hero. And if 100% isn't good enough, you just have to go beyond. And he yells out, now this is a mantra that shows up in the show multiple times, and it's even in the opening intro, plus ultra, which I have written down multiple times with question marks, because I have no idea what it means.
Yeah, I didn't either.
He rains over 300 of his mighty blows on Nomu, hitting him so hard and so fast and so precisely that the absorption is overcome, and he's able to do damage, and then hits him with one punch so powerful, he flies out of the entire facility.
But I thought those were his most powerful 300 punches. He has a more powerful one?
Well, you know, and he mentions in his heyday, it would have only taken four hits.
Five.
But five hits. Sorry. Yeah. And now it took over 300 mighty blows.
Yeah.
In the final episode, he then turns to the Red Blast villains and is like, all right, come at me. And Deku can see through all the smoke that has been created by this fight. Steam is starting to rise from his body, meaning he's about to transform back into his weak state. He is out of time, and he's completely bluffing on the villains, who then call him on it and attack him. While the other kid heroes are like, we'll take care of the red shirt villains behind us. All Might's obviously got this. Deku realizes he's screwed and jumps in to save him with his legs powering up. So he blows his legs, he powers up his arm, and the villains are ready for it. The portal guy creates a portal, hand guy reaches and is about to grab Deku when the pro heroes arrive, brought by Ida, a guy with a six-shooter revolver, starts firing down and knocks hand guy away. These pro hero teachers save everybody. So all the villains are arrested except for Hand Guy and Portal Guy manage to get away, and they retreat back, and we find them back at a bar where they're complaining about how this didn't work, they weren't prepared, and a voice over a TV, who they call Master, and there's a second voice there as well, tell them, don't worry about it, you know, we can do better next time. So there's someone pulling these villain strings, and we never find out who in these 13 episodes, right?
And real quickly, during that scene, Hand Guy complains that the information about All Might was wrong, thus revealing that there may be a mole or a spy within the hero organization.
Right. The villains are aware that All Might is not in his top form anymore. And they even mentioned earlier in the fight when he first attacks that he's like, he's so fast. But he's not as fast as he was supposed to be, right? Mm-hmm. To wrap up the episode, though, and the whole story, the police actually arrive, and Razorhead, 13, All Might, and Deku all are sent to recovery in the hospital because they're all majorly injured. Nomu is actually found and arrested.
He's very docile.
And he just takes it.
Waiting for commands, looks like.
And then a detective named Namisu Suguchi shows up, and they make a big deal about this character. He's the head cop that shows up. He asked for full access to the school. The rat mole thing of a principal, teddy bear, tells him, of course, and so is very trusting of him. And then he goes and talks to All Might and Deku, and we realize that he is actually one of the very few characters who know All Might's secret. And is All Might's, he refers to him as his best friend or one of his best friends. And he's telling All Might, you know, good job. You and Razorhead managed to fend off all these villains. And All Might says, no, it wasn't just us. The students did so much. This first year has seen more battle now than most students will ever see in school. And they're going to be a very powerful group because of it. And that's how the episode and season ends. Let's start with the fight. What did you guys think of this final fight?
It was great. I actually really appreciated it. It was a really neat combo between, you know, pushing through Ultra and All Might makes the comment that I literally cannot move or I will transform back. Like he is trembling, barely standing there in his form.
And even after the fight, where he's like half and half, right? You see, like,
yeah, that was cool.
His form is slowly changing even without his willing it.
Right, because he's trying to continue to hide himself from the rest. Mm-hmm. The one thing that did bother me is Revolver Guy was way too violent compared to everyone else. He literally shot bullets through 4 points within Hand Guy's body and used blood spurt. This is the first time you've seen a hero inflict mortal damage on somebody in a way that could kill them. Even Nomu, you see him get beat up by All Might, but All Might knows that he can take it, right? And he's not going to kill Nomu by doing this. That was the one thing that bothered me. But besides that, it was a great scene of back and forth, and then also the kids helping out, and Deku's moment to shine that gets turned around on him. So I thought that was.
I want to jump in here real quick on you, because the villain makes a statement when All Might shows up about why he's doing this. He calls All Might. Oh, he says, you heroes are just tools of government-sponsored violence, and you get to decide what acts of violence are heroic and what acts of violence are villainy. And so you mentioned this character who comes in and just starts shooting and is way more violent than we've seen before. And when the villain said that, and it kind of sucks because right after they call him on it, like, no, you're actually just crazy. He's like, oh, you're right, I am. But when he made that point, I was like, that's actually a really good point. You know, and he mentions Deku. Deku tried to kill me. That kid went for a full-on punch in my face. He would have killed me, and you're fine with it. You're supposed to be the heroes, and you're fine with people getting killed just because you say it's for good. And this character that comes in and does the shooting reinforces that a little bit. So maybe it was a good choice having him there to give the villain some traction in the reasoning. Because I do love a villain that has a point.
Yeah. On the topic of the more than 100% and plus ultra, this is one of the things that is characteristic of Shonen. So I kind of expected it, but it's one of the things that I don't like in Shonen. I understand that they always are presented as overcoming obstacles, and those obstacles have to be. It's like when I watched Gurren Lagann, or Lagan, or how do you say it right? When I watched that today, and it was like, well, I need more power. I'm just going to make more power. I have faith. And so there's always that sense in the Shonen, and I know that it's to instill a sense of tenacity and a sense of overcoming all obstacles with the right mindset. But for me, it's something I've also seen in Western comics, and it's always bugged me. Anytime that you have... Go ahead.
I would like for them to go someplace where they explain that Plus Ultra is a second gear for quirks, right? That's
what the school is there for.
That would make sense. Like,
that would be cool.
Yeah, I'm super strong all the time, but when I use my Plus Ultra, I can punch a guy across the state.
Right.
And then it wouldn't just be, I'm able to be stronger because I really, really want to be.
Yeah.
You make a valid point. I mean, Goku, you know, before he turns Super Saiyan 1, he just digs deep and all of a sudden he gets harder. Or, you know, Pikachu, he goes against the type that he's not strong enough, but Ash just tells him to try harder and he wins. And it's like, come on.
So that was one thing. That was one thing that just, for me, everything was kind of, it was rising and rising and rising, and I loved it, and the story felt good. Everything was doing well, and then all of a sudden it hits this point where I'm like, okay, I lost my sense of suspension of disbelief because the limits of the superheroes were defined and then broken. Another issue I had is when Eraserhead was getting smashed into the ground so hard that the ground was deforming around his face and forming craters. We know what his power is. His power is the ability to erase other people's powers for a limited time. He doesn't have a body of steel. We know how powerful Nomu is because he's supposed to be as powerful. So did I. And I thought there was a part of me that was absolutely horrified and ripped apart because I was like, I love this character. But there was also part of me that was like, this is good storytelling. This is what I want to see. I was actually disappointed. I want him to die.
I was disappointed that nobody died in
this fight. That's my second point.
I thought they killed 13. And I was like, that makes sense. They just introduced 13 and
to be killed.
And to be killed. And then they're fine. So that blow that you're talking about to Eraserhead just becomes an anime thing, right?
Yep.
Anime characters always hit ground and always create craters, and they're always just fine with it.
And blood was just flowing from his face. Yes. And he recovered. Yep. He's fine.
There were so many moments where you were being told that he's dead. So many blood spurts off camera shots where you couldn't see him, but you just saw a blood spurt. You see his glasses fly up and land, right? All of those are designed to make you think he's dead. They're playing that emotion, and that I didn't like.
The emotional impact for the students would have been a lot more if a character had died, a hero had died. Like, guys, you're not doing this for fun. This is life and death. People can die doing this. And
that's what I thought, too. Yeah.
And they act like that at the end, too. They talk about, like, oh, we learned what a real hero goes through this day. No one died. You didn't learn the truth about hero and villain.
There should have at least been a student that died, too. And there were candidates for this. There's 36 students, right? And I think, or wasn't it 36 that got separated into two classes? Right?
Something I don't know the number. Sorry.
Yeah, they talk about it in episode 3, I think. And so I think there's like 15 students in this class.
There are
20 students. Okay, there's candidates. You could pick a couple of students and then write that into the story. This is where I totally agree with you that the story starts falling apart, because the things that would have grabbed me and held me and finished this series off, this season off, weren't there. I have looked a little tiny bit because I just had to know, does it continue in this vein or does it change? And it sounds like things get more serious, but I have no idea what ramifications that has on student deaths or anyone else's deaths. But that's what I need. If they're going to keep doing this series, I need it to be like Hunter x Hunter in the Chimera Ant arc, where people are dying and I hurt for them.
So, that's fair. Yeah. So two thoughts from me. One is the funniest line in the entire anime is in the last episode. And that is where all the students are outside and they're sharing their experiences. They're like, oh, we were in this room, we're in this room. And Laser, Belly Beam Laser, goes to the first group. Yes. Like, did you know where I was? Do you want to know where I was? And they ignore him. He goes to the second group. Do you want to know where I was? They ignore him. He goes to the third group. Do you want to know where I was? And Sue finally asks him, fine, where were you? He turns to the camera, looks straight at the audience, and goes, it's a secret.
Yes.
I've watched this anime twice now, and both times I yelled out laughing at that line. It caught me off guard so much every time. And is really the thing that captures the humor about this. It comes out of nowhere, and it doesn't fit the gravity of the situation, but it does lighten it up.
There's another one on that topic of humor that comes out of nowhere. When the lightning guy used his power and went over the allocated wattage, fried his own brain, and was an imbecile. Oh my god, that was awesome!
I do love how the powers have consequences. They're not just, I can create a bunch of lightning, that's what I do. I can create a bunch of lightning, but it makes me an idiot. I can make anything float, but it makes me throw up. I can punch anything, but it destroys my body.
Exactly.
The other thing I wanted to point out was, in that final fight, the music, once again, I noticed, and I'm not the kind of person who notices music. I'm not good at that kind of thing. And I noticed it, especially the second time. I'm like, wow, this music is so good. And the camera work, I know it's an anime, it's a drawing, but they still have to pick a camera perspective, right? And how we, as the audience, the camera is spinning around All Might and Nomu as they're spinning around each other, punching each other. Really cool and different point of view for a fight scene. I really enjoyed that. So let's do our final review real quick and then do some theory before we announce our next episode and how to contact us. So let's start with you, Jason. Go ahead and give us your final review and give us a 1 to 5 Baka scale. Can you do that for us?
Yep. I enjoyed it. It really hit in my, you know, long running shonen heart, if you will. Great character development, and that's one of the big hooks for me. I really started to care about the characters. There were some characters I really wanted to care about that they didn't do a good job with, specifically the villains. Definitely worth a watch. Some of the story fell apart, so I will give it 4 out of 5 Bakas.
Okay, Jeremy, how about you?
Well, I went into it really getting connected to Deku as a character and then Kachan, and watching the two of them kind of switch spots, I think was a really, really cool thing. Seeing All Might's dual personality, like you were saying, Jason, about that character depth, it really is there. They do a good job getting you involved with the characters. The setting is really interesting to me. I think there's some things I need to either have answered or go farther with the theories that I've developed in it, and I'll mention those when we get to the theory section. But once it reached its peak, it exposed that it's not going to present you with serious consequences, at least not in season one, to things that you should have suffered those consequences. You should have suffered those losses. So I will also give it a 4. 4 Bakas.
Okay, if I'm with you. I'm at 4 Bakas myself. It does a lot of things really well that I think that sets it apart from other shonen long-running anime. I think if that is your type of anime, this is going to raise a bar for you. I think the characters as they present them, you tend to like them even faster than other animes I've watched, right? I keep going back to Naruto because that's also about a school of students and just ninjas instead of superheroes with unique powers. It takes a while to get to know those characters, a couple episodes. I love Sue the minute she spoke. And every time she spoke and revealed her character, I loved her more. And there's so many of these little superhero students. And even the heroes we meet. In the first episode, we see real-life pro heroes that have nothing to do with the school, going about their day, and they were really cool. You cared about them and their battle for I thought that wood guy was really cool.
Gene Man.
Genius.
And I don't want to just call it out as flawed for the same things that all long-running shonen anime do, but there is some wheel spinning a little bit. There is some, here's a fight, a little bit of story, a little bit of a breath, here's a fight, and doesn't really, by the time that shonen feel sets in, the surprises stop coming in this first season for me. So just 4 out of 5 for me. Anything you guys would like to have seen done differently specifically?
I'm right with Jeremy in that at least Eraserhead, the way they portrayed it, he should have died. But the big hitter for me, they had many opportunities, especially in a long-running shonen where they do their tangents. They had plenty of opportunity to not only give us a little more teasers with the villains, but at least give us some concrete reasons why they're villains and why they believe the symbol of peace must be destroyed.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with that. Jeremy, how about you?
So, my big theory for this is it revolving around the setting. I believe that this is a dystopian society. I don't know if it's worldwide or if it's just Tokyo, but I believe this is a dystopian society. I think all the indicators are there. I don't know if this is intended by the writer or if this is just I'm reading into it and it fits the bill.
So what are your indicators?
There are several indicators that came out. Tanya and I sat down, we watched the first 10 episodes, and then we talked about it for a long time, about a week and a half before we watched the rest. And what kept coming up was, you know, if the population is 80% of them have quirks, we're not really seeing those quirks integrated into everyday life or technology for everybody on the streets. So you don't see people coming to and from their homes or walking down the streets, extending their legs so that they can walk faster by being taller. You don't see them flying or hovering on ice. You don't see them spider webbing around. You don't see them using their powers for much of anything. The only thing you see is maybe a few cosmetic alterations, so some quirks that are cosmetic and don't really do anything. When you look at people that are working, so you have the crowd of news reporters, I didn't see a single one that even had a cosmetic quirk. And none of them were using their quirks to enhance their job performance. If you think about what that means, it means that that's not normal for them. They're not supposed to use their quirks in their occupation. Otherwise, they would be. Nobody had, like, earbuds connecting to flying robots or had some other kind of, you know, extending arm to reach out and put a microphone under somebody's mouth or a deep voice that would bellow and everybody would hear them, right? And so another thing that I saw was that the technology that the regular population had was almost indistinguishable from what we have today. And the technology that was present in the academy was very futuristic. They were capable of creating entire city blocks and just for simulations that they were going to use to demolish, creating entire rescue zones. So why the technology disparity existed is something that fits in, because if you look at the fact that Deku is fourth generation, that means that, I mean, I went through the numbers on this for days just to see, because I have time at work to think about stuff like this.
Nerd.
Yeah. And so I was calculating it up, and the minimum number that I'm willing to use is 15, 15, 15, 15. So you've got Deku is 15 at that point in time. If you say his mother was 15 when she had him, her mother was 15 when she had her, her mother was 15 when she had her, and you're also assuming that they're all firstborn, and you're assuming that that's the straight line right there, but that's the shortest distance in time I could come up with. And, you know, that's 60 years. So granted, that's when the first one showed up, you know, and that's not even, just because Deku's fourth generation doesn't mean that there weren't super, or there weren't quirk generations prior to when his great-grandma was born.
Well, I assumed it started out super rare and took a while to become common.
Exactly. And so I was thinking, well, what happens if you plot a straight line, since we don't have any indicator of what kind of arc to use? You plot a straight line back 60 years, you get 40%, since it's 80% right now, at 30 years ago. So from 30 years ago, you've got 40% climbing up to 80, if that's assuming a straight line. So if we look at what has developed in the last 30 years in our world, you have internet, PC, mobile computers, mobile phones, DNA fingerprinting, mapping of the human genome, GPS, large-scale wind turbines, photovoltaic solar energy, digital photography, videography, biofuels, self-driving cars, and there's so many more. And so why don't they have technologies based around what they could have extrapolated by examining these quirks?
Do you think maybe the quirks replace the technology? It comes up in Fullmetal Alchemist that regular science stopped advancing because they discovered alchemy, because they found out they could have powers. They didn't need to develop airplanes, right? Do you think that could be a case? Like, hey, we don't need to innovate. Our bodies are innovating now for us.
I think that that would present something that would be indistinguishable, because for that to be the case, they would be using their abilities all the time. In order for the quirks to replace the technology, they'd have to be evident and visible using them. But I don't see them using them. I mean, look at Deku's mother. She has that power to use small-scale telekinesis. But I don't ever see her. Yeah, I know. I don't ever see her. Thank you. Ever actually using that power in her day-to-day life. We don't see her very much. But that's the sense that I get. I mean, the numbers 80% having quirks, that's a really big number. It should be evident, like you're saying.
We are starting to run out of time here, but Jason, your thoughts on the theory?
I think there's some holes in it, just due to the lack of information, such as who is the government, who's running the government, the disparity you might sense from people in a dystopian society didn't feel like it was there. I think it's plausible, because he makes some good points about people just not using it. I mean, if you're talking 80%, most of the scenes that we see that have a large populace of people there, you don't see very many quirks.
So my thought, I kind of in the same boat as Jason. I do see the plausibility now that you've said your theory. I see Yes, but for me, what usually goes along with a dystopian society is missing. So there's still a school structure, most importantly. There's police. There's getting rich. So currency is still working very well in this world because Bakugo wants to become the richest hero. And everyone's got their goal. His number one goal is, I'm going to become the richest. I'm going to be better than All Might and just get rich. And so currency we see is still the little stuff like that. You know, the fact that there are still police, there is still a school.
There's press.
Grocery stores. Yeah, the press. There's still news reports. There's even internet and YouTube are all still up and running. I can see it doing dystopian and then rebuilding to this point. But I have a hard time believing they're in dystopia situation now. But that's just because of my interpretation of what that means.
I have a lot more evidence for it, but I know we're on a tight time, so I won't voice it.
Thank you. Guys, so in the next story arc and beyond, what would you like to see in this anime?
I want to see the villains fleshed out. I want to know who they are. I want to know why they hate everyone, why they feel oppressed, and why they feel they need to destroy this symbol of peace. Also, and speaking of symbol of peace, it's mentioned that as Deku gets stronger, All Might gets weaker because this all for one power can only be with one person at a time. And during the transfer, it's just that it's this slow leech of power from one person to another. So I would like to see that. I'm sure that will be explored more, but I definitely want to see that.
I want to see the students take a hit. I want to see the pro heroes take a hit. I want to know that this is an occupation that is going to be risking your life every day, and you're going to see people around you that you care about die. I want it to be real for them. And I don't know if, as a shonen, it's going to be able to deliver that, but that's what I want.
That's fair. I kind of missed what you wanted to see, but it kind of ties in with this. I felt it was a missed opportunity because when I first started watching this, I'm like, this is going to be great. He's going to be the hero, the quirkless hero, right? And I thought that's where it was going, and it didn't. And I'd like them to give some validity to being quirkless, and you're not a worthless human being. Because this is like, hey, you're not special, so you're not special. And then, no, but look, we can make you special. But yeah, you were definitely not special. Where I want the message to be, I prefer my message to be everyone is special, even if you aren't special. And this really rammed against that. And so just for my personal preference, I would like to see a non-quirk character be as awesome as all these quirky characters.
How would you have him go about doing that?
I would have liked to see him become the Batman of this universe with All Might using his funds to support that.
Okay, that's cool.
I love that idea.
That's great.
I honestly thought that's where it was going because he's like, yeah, I can only do this. I can be Superman for 3 hours a day now. I can't do this. You have the heart of a hero, but you also suck. I'm going to train you. I'm going to do everything to be a hero, but you've already got the mentality. And because when he threw the backpack, that felt very Batman to me. Like, I'm going to use my environment. I'm going to use strategy to beat this hero or to beat this villain. And he didn't beat the villain. And the show is like, no, you have to have a power, idiot. and confirmed everything that everyone told him. Okay, so that's going to wrap it up for us, unless you guys have any final thoughts.
Final thought, I think the cop that is All Might's best friend is the mole feeding the villains information.
Ooh.
Do you think there's anything behind... I wrote this down, I wasn't going to bring it up. I'm going to bring it up now. When All Might first meets Deku, he says, you don't have a quirk, go be a cop. And then we find out his best friend is a cop. Do you think there's any connection, or is that just two random incidents?
I think it is, because All Might specifically said that this All for One power has been passed on from generation to generation, meaning he was passed it, meaning he may have been a cop with him and he got the power bestowed upon him.
Yeah, because he had to be quirkless, right? All Might doesn't have two quirks.
Nope.
No, that's not true.
Oh, did he have a quirk?
No, from what I understood, there was a point where Deku said, oh, you were going to go to the academy to be a teacher, and you were going to be looking for someone with an outstanding quirk to pass this power down to. You don't have to be quirkless to receive it.
No, you don't have to be quirkless, but All Might has never shown a second quirk or mentioned it. So it's theory, right? Let's turn our focus to our next anime. This is being picked by Jason. You can watch it on Amazon Prime, I believe, is the only place. So I hope most people have Amazon Prime. It's a great service. I love it. And they're not even paying me to say that. If they want to pay me to say that, I will say that more. But, yeah, so this is only being displayed by Amazon Prime, as far as I know. It's Kabaneri of the Iron Fortress, also known as Kotetsuju no Kabaneri. It is created by Wit Studio, who also created Attack on Titan. And it is set during the Industrial Revolution. Zombies have taken over the land. They have hearts made of iron or iron cover of their hearts. Humans are relying on trains to transport through these zombie-infested lands in their safe ports. And our main character gets infected but manages to survive and becomes a human-zombie hybrid and develops a weapon to help fight against these zombies. And it's about train travel with zombies by the Attack on Titan people. That should be very exciting. It's only 12 episodes long, so it's a little bit shorter than what we watched these past 2 weeks. So I hope you guys enjoy that, and we will come back and talk about that. If you want to reach us, you can reach us at Twitter, at Baka Podcast, or email theanimebakaclub@gmail.com. And our mini-sode that's coming up, what is the topic on that? Jeremy, you picked that this for
Slice of Life. We're just going to analyze it and talk about it.
Slice of Life anime, which is definitely not in our strong wheelhouse. I think that's fair to say for all three of us.
Yes, absolutely.
So we wanted to just touch on that and get it through. So that's it for us, guys. I hope you enjoyed the episode. We would like any support you can give, but mostly continue the discussion that we started here. Tell us who was right. Tell us who was wrong. We'd love to hear from you. Say goodbye, everybody.
Have a good night.
Sayonara. Bye.